I'm going to do a video on the notation and why I use some of the conventions that I use at the modern relativity site of mine. Like quantum mechanics, a lot of people on the planet can plug and chug numbers of relativity, but in my opinion, the people who actually understand the ideas behind what they are doing are actually very few. A lot of people around the planet can build boats, read boats and such, but what percentage of them actually understand the concept of buoyancy? I'm going to start with this Feynman quote. There was a time when the newspapers said that only 12 men understood the theory of relativity. I do not believe there ever was such a time. There might have been a time when only one man did, but because he was the only guy who caught on before he wrote his paper. But after people read the paper, a lot of people understood the theory of relativity in some way or other, certainly more than 12. On the other hand, I think I can safely say that nobody understands quantum mechanics. I think Feynman was being generous, either that or he was just thinking about special relativity. I'm more of the opinion that I could count on my fingers and toes the number of people that have actually understood general relativity since Einstein till today. But at any rate, I also think that he was actually misquoting a paper. I think he was quoting a paper that was quoting Eddington, who had said that there was only three people that had understood relativity since Einstein. Einstein himself, and that he couldn't remember who the third person was. I think he was kind of joking, but if there was such a third person, I would propose that it was Emmy Noether. In fact, I think she probably understood relativity better than him, and maybe even better than Einstein by the time she died. But at any rate, my point is that a lot of people can plug and chug numbers from relativity and quantum mechanics, but can't tell you why they choose their conventions beyond which it's just a matter of choice. You can choose this or that. Well, I'm going to explain to you my understanding of relativity as it applies to at least one of my very important conventions, which I'll start out with, and explain why I use some of the others. So the first convention that I want to go over is why I use the sign convention metric. The metric for special relativity is this eta mu nu. And a lot of people will tell you it's purely a sign convention. There's no reason to choose one way or the other how you build your mathematics. And as far as plugging and chugging numbers goes, that's true. But I have a conceptual reason that I use the 1 minus 1 minus 1 minus 1 signature for the metric, as opposed to the more common minus 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 convention for the metric. I want to start out by looking at what do we mean by this S in ds squared here. A lot of people use S to represent a path integral element of the ds. But why do they use S? What does S have to do with a path? Well, the S is just a squiggle. It just represents a visual representation of a curve. And so most people will use the minus 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 convention because they're thinking of S as a distance length for a path. But in relativity, what we mean by the length of a path is actually not a distance. I want to look at this diagram that I have, in which I place CT on the vertical axis and X on the horizontal axis. I draw this path on it, and this path represents some real thing in space-time, something like a test particle or the location of an observer in space-time. And we notice that the location of the observer in space-time is not one point. He exists for some time interval, and so it's actually a curvy path. That squiggle, that S in relativity, represents not just the geometry of space-time, but as far as real particles, signals, and observers are concerned, it represents what's referred to as a world line, a path of space-time. Now that path, since it occurs all at where that, say, observer is, and I say that it's an observer moving back and forth a little bit up that red line, all the events along that path occur where he is. They occur where his watch is. So those events, those dots along those that line, can be thought of as ticks of his watch. That path describes then his coordinate of time at his location. So here I'm going to show you the red line for a unaccelerated observer, and you notice that his path through space-time is not so much a distance, really. It is a proper time interval. It is his time axis. So the real particles, real signals, real observers moving through our space-time have a ds-squared describing their path that corresponds to their time. So given that information, it only makes sense in terms of pedagogy to define ds squared, the square of the length of that path through space-time, as something that is positive for real massive particles, for real observers. And to do that, you need the plus 1, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1 sign convention. Because what that ds squared represents, then, from this perspective, is the square of the length of the proper time interval for that path through space-time. And that proper time interval is something that is real for real observers. And so for real observers, the things traveling less than the speed of light, it only makes sense then to define it so that the square of its length is positive.
Now you can, of course, draw paths through space-time for which the path is space-like, in which case with my sign convention, the ds squared would be negative, but that kind of a path does not describe the path of a real signal particle because they can't travel faster than the speed of light. And so what I'm telling you, and with that quote from Feynman and such, is that, yeah, I know a lot of other places use the opposite sign convention, but that to me manifests that those people who you're reading those sites from don't actually understand relativity. As deep as what they're writing may be, it's really just quotes and plug and chug in with the information that is now available on relativity today. Anybody today doing relativity that really understands relativity would, in my opinion, be using the plus, minus one, minus one, minus one sign convention. I also want to look at For example, the square of the length of the velocity 4 vector. If you use my sine convention for the metric, that is c squared. If you use the other sine convention, it's minus c squared. It makes more sense to use the metric that would give you something that is positive. And so, of course, you want to use the plus, minus, 1, minus, 1, minus, 1 sine convention. Likewise, the square of the length of the momentum 4 vector for real particles, if you use my sine convention, is plus m squared c squared. It doesn't make sense that you would want the length squared of a momentum 4 vector to be negative for real particles. Yes, you can do all of the mathematics fine and get final results calculated for velocities and positions and stuff using the other sine convention. Yes, you can do that all self-consistently and it works out, but it would be like taking the energy equation and saying, well, you know, 1/2 mv squared is conserved. Therefore, if we define our energy all across the board, potentials and everything, reverse all of the signs and call energy negative, you would still have something that's conserved. So I want to use a sine convention that says energy is minus 1/2 mv squared. Well, you can do that in a self-consistent way, but it doesn't make sense to. If you understand energy and momentum and mass, you would want to choose it in such a way that for real mass, real signals, real observers, these quantities are going to come out to be positive. So that's why I use that sine convention and what my understanding of relativity is behind which I reason to use the sine convention there that I use. Okay, the next convention I want to point out is that I don't plug in C and G and stuff equal to 1 everywhere in the text. Now, I gotta admit, in real life, when I'm, for example, using software and doing some plug and chug numbers, I tend to let C be 1 and just leave that off. So, for example, if I'm gonna do a software calculation for the Einstein tensor for a metric that I wanna plug in, when I tell the computer what coordinates I want to use for within the line element, I will just use T. I won't use CT. However, the reason that I leave C's and stuff in the book is because even though it's easy to take the C's and stuff and put them equal to 1, and then you wind up with geometric or Planck units, like a lot of texts use, and compare that way, it's a lot harder for people that are used to using other units like SI and such, for which the C's are not equal to 1. And so I figure for their sake, I'll do the site where I will not set C equal to 1, and then for people who want to use C and stuff equal to 1, well, it's easy just to drop the C's, and they should be able to understand the site just fine. Now, on the other hand, there's another choice as to whether you want to, in the line element, put the C with the T term or with the XYZ terms. Now, I just went through describing how that path through space-time is really a time-like path when you're considering real signals, real mass particles, describing their paths through space-time. So you'd think that I would be using the second notation convention here, where I put the C's divided through on the XYZ terms, but I don't. And the reason that I don't is really just that I like to use as few C's as possible if I'm going to put in the C's. So, you notice right here in this one expression from the get-go, I would have three C terms as opposed to one for X0 being CT. So, basically, I just put the C on the time term instead of the XYZ terms in the metric because I write less C's in all of the equations that way. Okay, the next convention that I want to go over is do you use 0 through 3 or 1 through 4? Einstein used 1 through 4 with the fourth dimension being the time coordinate. It's becoming more and more popular today to use 0 through 3, where the time is the zeroth coordinate. And again, referring to some understanding of relativity, not plug and chug, I have a reason for using the 0 through 3 as opposed to the 1 through 4. The reason that I use CT for the zeroth coordinate is because there are sections in which I want to display a visual representation of what space-time curvature looks like with embeddings such as for wormholes, for example, how the space curvature looks for a Schwarzschild black hole, for example. In which case, I would want to add more spatial coordinates. So I wouldn't want to write it as x1, 2, 3 being spatial, x4 being time, and x5 going back to spatial, because that mixes up where the space and time are written. I mean, you can do that, but it seems more organized to me to isolate the time coordinate and then write the space-like coordinates following after. So if I wanted an extra-dimensional space-like axis, it would be x with the superscript of 4. Usually that's how I do that. Thinking back, I do believe I did that differently for the small section that I did on Kaluza-Klein theory, just because that's closer to how the original authors of that did it, and so it makes it easier for people to compare the results. But otherwise, normally I use these time for the zeroth coordinate. The expression for where I put the primes on a tensor transformation equation. I put the prime next to the letter for the tensor itself and not on each of the indices. And the reason that I'm doing that is that there are people who are following the text who put the prime on the indices who are making the mistake of thinking that the what you are transforming is the index itself. And the index really is just a number, 0, 1, 2, 3, like the superscripts that you just saw. Sometimes I use letters that correspond to coordinates for the indices like x, y, z, or r, theta, phi, whatever. But in reality, it's just a number. T, mu, nu is not really the entire tensor. The tensor is actually a set of, in this case, 16 elements. T mu nu is a representation for one of those elements of that 16-set tensor that obeys tensor transformation properties. So what it is that you are really transforming by doing this transformation is not the indices, but it's that UNU element of that set that constitutes the tensor. So when I write this element notation, T prime UNU, what I'm saying is that what you have transformed is the one of those 16 elements that corresponds to the indices mu and nu. And then in an abstract way, you infer that that same transformation is done to all of those tensor elements. So that is why I put the prime in the one place next to the letter for the tensor. It's saying that this T mu nu is one element of the tensor as expressed according to the primed frame, as opposed to putting the prime on each of the indices. It's not saying that that these are the indices according to some frame. The indices are the indices regardless of frame. It's the one T mu nu element, that's one element, that's associated with a prime or unprime frame. So I only use one prime on that side of the equation. And finally, I want to refer back to the metric expression that I had written down. You notice that I put these brackets around the eta sub mu nu. There's a reason that I do that as well. Some other authors do it differently. Some don't even use the brackets around it. The reason why I do that is because, again, eta mu nu is not really the tensor itself. Eta mu nu is one element, the mu nu element, of a 16-element set. And that set can, in this case, be represented by a 4x4 matrix. So I put the brackets around the eta mu nu to remind the reader that this is a set of elements, and one element is represented by the eta mu nu. That's why what I use for the site is called element notation. It's because you're expressing an element of the set of numbers that constitute a tensor. So hopefully that clears up for some people why I use some of the notations that I use, and points out that other authors do some of them differently so that they're wary of when they apply some of the expressions from my site to some from other texts, not to be sloppy when they mix the equations, because you can get wrong answers if you use one equation from my text that uses one set of conventions and one equation from another text that uses another set of conventions. Signs get wrong, orders of indices can be taken wrong because they may correspond to sign conventions and such, and then you can actually get wrong answers. So you got to be careful about conventions when mixing results from various different texts.